thank you all for coming out today. I was really privileged to get to say a couple words before we start, but I think recently we might have had some mixed messages, and I wanted to clarify that. We keep talking about our campus as this, you know, robust undergraduate institution, and, you know, research might not be a focus of what we do, but you know what? Teaching without scholarship, I think, is fairly dead teaching. And I guess being a late-to-life academic and having to learn how to do this at the ripe old age of almost 50, it grows you when you begin to do the research, when you put together a paper, when you get it published, when your peers tell you whether they think it's worthwhile or not. Sometimes that can be fun, mostly it's painful. But in the end, you grow from that experience. And one thing I have found since I've been here is how incredible the scholarship is here and how incredible the teaching is here, and I think the two go together. We have several papers. I think toward the end we're going to hand some certificates out and ask our Chief Academic Officer, Dr. Bloom, to help with that. But I know we have three speakers today, and I know that Sally and Dorothea, who we're giving her a hard time lately. We're calling her Mercury since her hazardous material spill. And Brad Waller are going to spend a little time chatting with us today. And we are privileged to have scholars like this among us. We're privileged to have scholars, as you see printed in your handbook, among us. And so I'm really looking forward to a great afternoon. I also like to thank Sarah and the staff of the library for putting this on. There needs to be a forum for us to share these thoughts and ideas amongst ourselves. And so I'm very glad to be a part of this today. And I will get off the stage and let the people who came to talk. Thank you.
Thank you for your welcome, Dr. Ayers. I'm so happy and so pleased that you've come to the fifth annual, the sixth program of the Scholarly Speaking to recognize and celebrate publications of the Prescott campus authors. First of all, I'd like to thank the committee of members, Joanne Ivanova, Suzanne DeLong, Evelyn Harris, Kathy Hill, Susie Roth, and Pat Watkins for all of their hard work to produce this program. We believe that it is important for librarians and faculty to work together to recognize the scholarship that occurs on this campus. The goals of the Scholarly Speaking program are to heighten the awareness of research and scholarly activities on the Prescott campus, to promote the library as a supporter of academic endeavors, to encourage and support publications, to educate the community on the value of scholarly publications. This year, we have produced a bibliography with 23 authors. After the program, we will add your publications to the library special collections. The citations were included for the calendar year of 2009 only from those authors that provided them, and this is not a complete list. There may be other authors that aren't included. Today, I'm excited to present those authors who have works published or papers presented in the year 2009. When I call your name, please come up to the front to celebrate your publications with a certificate of recognition from the library. Please hold your applause to the end. Okay, Quentin Bailey, Time Delay and Doppler Test of the Lorentz Symmetry of Gravity, Catching Relativity Violations with Atoms, Lorentz Violation and Gravitivity.
I do research on the tests of general relativity, which is our best current theory of gravity. So the simplest thing, that's what I do.
And with all due gravity, I'd like to thank Dr. Bailey for this certificate.
Thank you.
Sally Blomstrom, Research in Progress Communicating STEM, Active Learning Toolbox, an Exchange of Ideas That Work. How and to what extent does service learning pedagogy enhance communication and collaboration skill learning among first-year students? Assessment of the basic speech course, comparing service learning with other pedagogies, Entrepreneurship Program Assessment by Student Outcome. Richard Bloom. Richard Bloom, are we too conflicted to understand conflict? Review of understanding conflict and conflict analysis. Assessing the dark side. Review of the evaluation of child sexual abuse allegations. A comprehensive guide to assessment and testimony. Biography of the bully pulpit. Review of Richard Rorty, The Making of the American Philosopher. A government primer. What good people should know about detecting bad people. The November 2008 Mumbai terrorist attacks, lessons learned from Homeland Security. Panel on contemporary issues in aviation security. Terrorism, how should the U.S. fight air security threats? There is no single security hole.
Richard, have you thought of publishing something this year?
Well, at my age, I don't think much about anything.
Okay, Stacy DeVoe. Using NASA data in the classroom.
I'm working on my master's in space education and in doing the NASA outreach, trying to find ways to better get that information, bring it down from that level into classrooms. Thank you.
Erica Hill. Moral development in pilot populations.
It's been a long time in coming to get it published, so.
Okay, Javad Gorgidus was unable to make it today. Peter Gray, is he here? Peter Gray. James Helbling. Didn't see him. Dorothea Ivanova. Structure and Evolution of the North American Monsoon in Arizona, Observational and Modeling Studies, Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University McNair Scholars Program, Students Learning and Their Future Career in Meteorology. Curtis James is just signing in now, and Proper Weather Radar Interpretation, Structure and Evolution of the North American Monsoon in Arizona, Observational and Modeling Study.
I was just invited to talk at the MLPA convention for the Malibu Mirage Owners House Association. And I talked to them for about an hour and a half or so about interpreting the radar screen and learning how to be safe for pilots. So.
And Philip Jones, Eileen Landis-Groom, A Matter of Discovery.
What did you discover?
It's a long story.
David Lanny. Prerequisite skills testing as an indicator of student retention.
It's a nice break from grading.
Nancy Lawrence. And Nika Nordbrock said she would be unable to attend. Gary Northam.
Gary's in Daytona.
Kenneth Parsons. I didn't see him. Yes. Okay, good. Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University McNair Scholar Program. Students learning in their future career in meteorology.
Well, I was just fortunate enough to be able to tag along with Dorothea, who did the writing and made the presentation. That it's great to be associated with the McNair program, and it's been a real valuable experience to me, and I hope to the students as well.
Ed Post. Introduction to heat sink selection and installation, a universal direct conversion receiver for PSK-31.
Thank you.
Just a couple of the many low and resting problems in electrical engineering.
Sabrina Rick, if I saw her. Mark Sinclair is in Phoenix. William Waldock, aircraft accidents and emergency response, the influence of maintenance on aviation safety, the crash of Air France Flight 447.
Easy subject. About those French.
Bradley Wall. Shape-based approach to low-thrust rendezvous trajectory design, method and solution for the 2009 Global Trajectory Optimization Contest.
That competition thing isn't in my speech, but I worked with some of my colleagues still back at the University of Illinois, and we collaborated on an annual competition in our field of study and finished 18th out of 47 teams in the world.
Wow.
John. Using blocks to enhance teaching and learning Mandarin Chinese, collaborative learning, a way to transform learning and instruction in online courses.
So my research interest is in integrating technology in classroom, and basically it's more focused on foreign language teaching. But now I'm more excited about my current research project, which is using Second Life to teach Chinese.
Thank you. I want to thank those of you who completed the follow-up survey last year. Several of you expressed the desire to have our own faculty present their experiences instead of having a guest speaker. So this year, the committee decided to ask one faculty from each of the colleges to give a summary of their research, writing, and publishing experiences. Thank you in advance to Drs. Blomstrom, Ivanova, and Wall, who agreed to speak today. Please hold your questions until the end, when the speakers are finished. Our first speaker is Dr. Blomstrom from the College of Arts and Sciences, who teach humanities and communications. She is a member of the Library Advisory Committee. Thank you, Sally.
Today I'm going to talk a little bit about the research that I do, and then talk about one publishing avenue, one publishing outlet that I thought you might find interesting. It's a little unusual. So, perspectives on publishing. Thank you to Dr. Ayres, Dr. Bloom, especially my dean, all of the deans who are so supportive here, our chair, our previous chair, and the terrific colleagues I get to work with, particularly Dr. Beattie, Dr. Nordbrock, and Dr. Hyland-Diskern, who make my research possible, and everybody here today as well. So, quick background, my education is all in communication, my bachelor's, master's, and PhD. Did the same thing all the way through. Most of my professional career, however, has been in industry. I worked in financial derivatives for a number of years, and then owned a business with my brother and sister-in-law in Southern California. And after we sold that, I came into academia. So, and I'm very pleased to be here. What I study service learning. And service learning, this is the definition from Brindle and Hatcher, but service learning essentially is a service opportunity for students to apply their academic content. And I'll give you some examples about this. And then I also look at assessment. So one of the papers was on how and to what extent does a service learning pedagogy enhance communication and collaborative skills. Those of you in engineering will recognize that as 3D and 3G criteria from ABET. This was one of the articles that was published in the Prescott Courier last summer about what we do. In general, the students in my classes, and we had the opportunity to work with Stacy DeVoe on most of these, and we are just beginning to work with Debbie Opitz in Upward Bound. Students in the COM 219 classes that I teach develop and deliver presentations on science, technology, engineering, and math topics to a variety of audiences. So those include Kids and Company after school program, It includes now, this term, in fact, in about 2 weeks, we'll be going out to classrooms in the elementary and junior high schools around the Prescott area. And the students have a way of bringing science, technology, engineering, and math to life for these younger students. And then the younger students get enthused about them. And we see through repeated exposures that there's increased enthusiasm in the younger audience. By this point, Stacy and I have had the good pleasure of working with students in my classes to reach over 1,000 contacts in the Prescott school system. So that's the basic research that I do. And more recently with Debbie, we went into the high schools and talked about career opportunities. So these are just some of the venues that we have worked in. So how does that become research? Well, when I looked in the literature, I found that there were some gaps, that service learning was becoming a popular pedagogy in communication, but there weren't standard ways to assess it. So teachers thought it was effective, but we didn't have quantitative ways to show that in fact it was. So that was one of the big areas. Service learning had not been compared with other pedagogies, nor was service learning compared between institutions. So those are some of the aspects that I cover. To address the need for standardization, the biggest part of my research is we developed a tool based on expectations for students who have taken one college class. These were put together by the state, implemented that with employer perspectives through the Commission on Public Relations Education, and I read employer surveys as well as alumni surveys. So we developed that and then used it as a pretest and a post-test. I've had the good fortune of having some publications and presentations to service learning audiences, communication audiences, ASEE, as well as the Scholarship of Teaching and Learning. One of the more interesting ones was best practices in experiential and service learning in communication. This just came out last month, so it wasn't on the list. But I wanted to show you. This book was somewhat interesting. It was interesting because the editors felt that some of the academic articles were not getting to a very broad audience. So they primarily put together an electronic book. Very few hard copies were made. So most of the people who purchased this purchased it online in this format. So all of us who contributed wanted to reach a larger audience, and we shared the editor's philosophy on this. So I hadn't done that before. Previously, I admitted work to hard copy journals or to books, but this time it's electronic. So I'm hoping, and again, it's only been a month, so we don't know what the readership is, but I'm hoping it will reach a broader audience. So in short, I just feel very privileged to be here. I want to thank my colleagues. This is a great opportunity for me, and the service learning research has been a great deal of fun as well as very rewarding. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Our next speaker will be Dr. Ivanova from the College of Aviation, who teaches meteorology. Thank you, Dorothea.
Thank you. I wanted to use this opportunity to defend meteorology. Meteorology, many people, especially people that are not involved in meteorology, think of meteorology as some kind of weather forecasting tool only. Actually, meteorology is the physics and the chemistry of the atmosphere. It includes in itself satellite meteorology, air pollution meteorology, instrumentations for all these observations, weather information systems, remote sensing. There is much more to meteorology research than just synoptics. And synoptics is what everybody thinks of when they think about meteorology. So cloud physics, climate research, all these parts are underrepresented in the public's mind. And talking about the applied research, which meteorology is basically applying the basic laws of physics, of chemistry, thermodynamics, and dynamics. And it's not basic research, of course, but it is very influenced by the basic research and is also influencing on its own the basic research, because some of the concepts have changed dramatically during the past 200 years. So talking about meteorology research, what I do is I started first with ozone in the stratosphere, satellite metals. I worked in NASA and in NOAA before I came here. And then I shifted more toward climate studies, monsoon, North American monsoon, also known as Mexican or Arizona monsoon. And my other passion is studying the microphysics of the ice clouds, cirrus clouds. Lots of observations are taken from airplane flights through the cirrus clouds. In situ, also remote sensing observations from satellites. And then we do these parameterizations that enter into the global climate models that you know as GCMs. And this is very important because until 5 years ago, cirrus clouds were not represented in the global climate models. This brings a huge uncertainty, and the same is valid for the aerosols. So cirrus clouds and aerosols are basically the two big uncertainties that bring the biggest error and standard variation in the data that enters as input, initial conditions, before you run the climate models. So here I put one statement about the applied meteorology, applied research, that we all have been taught during our undergraduate and graduate years from the point of view of the scientific method that applied research deals with practical problems and is generally empirical. But is that really true? I have been questioning this for the past several years. And one other point that I want to make is about hypothesis and meteorology. On purpose, I put hypothesis in Greek here, because most of my colleagues agree that formulating a really clear hypothesis is something that is most difficult when you are first starting with one research problem. You need some motivation. This is an example of motivation in remote sensing, in working with satellites. There are sometimes no other ways, like for example, if you look at point two here, only way to examine what is really happening from the point of view of cloud physics, cloud resolving models. They also are part of the big numerical prediction models and of the climate models. So this serves as a motivation. But manage to formulate your hypothesis, you have to always expect that alternative hypothesis exists, and to be able to deal with this possibility and to be able to deal with your research, it is crucial to really have a clear methodology and to explain to your peers that are going to read your papers or listen to your presentations, to explain how your methodology really works. Sometimes we do flow charts like this one. We say often that a picture is worth 1,000 words. Not for the large public, but for cloud physicists, it is very clear what are the input properties here, what are the input properties, temperature, ice water content, etc. What is the procedure and what are the output properties. Of course, we explain everything, what is what in our papers. And sometimes we don't use flowcharts, sometimes we just write about the methodology that we are using. Why am I talking about methodology? Because this is the biggest problem when you review a paper. Sometimes the authors, non-intentionally probably, hide the details of what they do and exactly how they do it. And if you hide your methodology, then your results are not reproducible. And it is difficult to evaluate such results. And then one of the most important parts in our research is also how to present the research findings. And this is in every field, I believe. And again, we try to show images, results that speak for themselves. For example, this is a part of our research in the North American monsoon. And here you see on the left, you have Northern Gulf of California. These are two modeling simulations. On the left, you have Northern Gulf of California sea surface temperatures, 29.5 degrees. This is what happens, and the yellow is the precipitation, the rain, 24-hour accumulation. To the right, you see the same, the rain accumulation with sea surface temperatures already 30 degrees. So this is just half a degree difference, but the onset of the monsoon is immediate. And then the way you present your results, like from a modeling study, you usually put time series of the convective available potential temperature or whatever you're interested in, studying the properties of the boundary layer or different things. But you show different simulations, you show what a difference the time lag period makes and different other parameterizations. Basically, we are trying to present your results in a clear way so the public and the readers like it. The next is another example of presenting your results. If you compare, for example, tropical cirrus clouds with mid-latitude, you can show your main findings by comparing both cases for the same temperature X, size distributions that enter as main component of the input conditions of the global climate models. So the process of academic publishing and peer review is very different in different disciplines. For us, we have presented conferences, our findings, and then, of course, we are tagged, it's welcome, we are tagged by our colleagues. This is the way you receive your first feedback, and then your work improves. You listen to the constructive criticism, and you have to, because you will never improve if you don't. Of course, you ignore some things that you disagree with, or you refute them, and you continue. And then after you have presented at the conference or symposium, you start writing your paper. You submit. Almost never it goes through the first time. It comes back with minor corrections, major corrections, and then you work on the corrections, read the reviewers' points, improve and submit again. That's the process of peer review publishing. I also want to make one important point here, and I want to talk about involving undergraduate students in our research. Many universities involve graduate students in the research, and that's what all we have done while we were doing our master's and our doctorate theses and dissertations. But I think undergraduate time for many bright students is the time to introduce them to the scientific method, to introduce them to the joy of the research, even if you have to really walk them hand by hand, baby steps in the beginning. Many of them will go to graduate school and will be involved in the future research, and we have to do this. And here we have two wonderful programs. I want to thank the McNair program. Olga has done a wonderful job with the McNair program. Here's my McNair student, Mary. I have had several of these students already. And the other program, Dr. Ron Medler, has the NASA Space Grant for the undergraduate students. And already I have had five students from that were funded by the NASA Space Grant, and they also did a wonderful job. And I will look forward to work with more of these students. So we come to the question of freedom. How free are you if you don't have funding? So that's why we have to constantly write grants for the NSF and NASA and NOAA and other funding agencies. And it's funny that NSF put this slide distribute this slide, and my main point here is, yes, what do you do if you don't get funded? And the NSF standard answer is, you start again, writing proposals, and continuing, and then again, and again, and again. In our field, only 10% of the grant proposals get funded, which means you write 10 proposals, you get one funded.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Dr. Wall from the College of Engineering, who teaches aerospace engineering. He is a member of the Library Advisory Committee. Thank you, Brad.
Hello, good afternoon. I was asked to speak today to give engineers' insight into research, the why, the what, and the how. Let me begin with the why we do research. A quote from our campus mission statement. Our mission is to emphasize academic excellence in the teaching of all courses and programs, to recruit and develop excellent faculty and staff, which I believe we have, and to pursue research and creative activities that maintain and extend knowledge in aviation, aerospace, and related disciplines. The key here, to me, is to pursue research and creative activities that maintain and extend our knowledge. For if we stop learning, what hope is there for our students? To this end, many of the research proposals written by the College of Engineering aim to better our current curriculum. For example, one such proposal written this past year aimed to add a third academic track to the aerospace engineering curriculum, adding it to the existing aero and astro tracks. The academic track we wrote to add was a research track. The idea was to single out potential graduate students as juniors and design a three-course research and development curriculum based on one technical elective course and a preliminary and detailed research design sequence. These students would learn as juniors the answer to the question, research, the why, the what, the how, and then put that knowledge into practice as seniors with the help of a faculty advisor with a research project. This proposal was aimed at helping our engineering faculty perform quality research and help our undergraduates seek out graduate school opportunities or research and development jobs at the same time. This is why we do research, not only for our minds, but the minds of our students. So what do engineers research if it doesn't directly deal with our courses that we teach? Topics range wildly from machine vision, aircraft aerodynamics, orbital debris, electrical engineering. And what I do personally is optimal spacecraft trajectories. I research on how to get from point A to point B, and possibly point C, D, E, F, and G, etc., usually while minimizing the propellant used, but sometimes minimizing some other performance objective. Now this research, my research, exists because there is no analytical solution to our problem, at least no one's found one in the last 200 years. And twice a year, our research in this small specialized field get together for a conference to discuss our latest findings and techniques and just extend the state-of-the-art methodology that's so important to research. It is at these conferences that I too present my research and get feedback from my peers at NASA and other universities throughout the world. These discussions shape my research goals for the next year and beyond and are invaluable to the research process. The contacts made can also be invaluable to our students, whether it be for a job or a graduate school opportunity. Just this past February, I had the pleasure of going to a conference in San Diego. Thank you, Richard. And presented a paper that was co-authored by two undergraduate students here that worked with me this past summer on a space grant. This research experience culminated in a conference paper that was very well received, and may very well be the difference for these two individuals getting a job or a graduate school opportunity, especially in this tough economic climate. Which brings me to the how. Research always begins with knowing what has been done before you. It's impossible to know where you're going unless you know where you've been. This starts with a library database search for topics of interest to accumulate a list of articles. Then one continues by looking up the book and article references in these articles. And if you don't have it here, trust me, this library can get it for you. I've used the interlibrary loan I don't know how many times, and within a couple of days, I have the book that I'm looking for. Right? And you get these references to get more background information and more historical information. Now, historical information oftentimes gets overlooked, but I find it an extremely important contribution to the process, maybe not for the research itself, but most definitely to extend my knowledge of the general subject matter. There are a few things that interest me more than stories of great discoveries of yesteryear, the laws of planetary motion and the founding of the calculus of variations, to name a couple. The next step in the research process typically involves reproducing the results of one of these articles that you've uncovered. In my line of research, that means to start simple and then make it more complicated one step at a time. While painstakingly slow sometimes, this has proved to be my most fruitful methodology. This is probably the hardest thing to teach our students, to start slow and simple and make it more complicated later. Progress is slow. Very few times in the history of the world have great leaps ever been made. Once you realize this, then you can accept spending years devoted to one specialized topic, even one problem. And once that problem is done, it is time to publish. Whether it be published in a conference proceedings or a peer-reviewed journal, it doesn't matter much to me. I'm already thinking about the next problem. Thank you for your time.
Are there any questions that you have for our speakers? Yes, Evelyn.
Okay. Could any one of you tell us, in a time frame, how long does it take from when you start your research to publishing? A year, 2 years, 5 years, 6 months?
That's why, personally, I prefer the conferences, because we did the research this past summer, and I presented in February, and it'll be printed almost immediately following the conference. If I submit to a journal article, I probably get it back probably 4 to 6 months later with my peer review, and then once I send it back and it finally gets approved, that's 9 months, and then I probably have to wait another year until I actually see it in the publication. By that point, it's already out of date in our field. So that's why I definitely prefer the conference proceedings, even though it's less peer review.
Okay, a follow-up question. Does electronic publishing, has that made a difference? Do you see a difference in that whole time span?
Only slightly. Like it will get online maybe 6 months before it's printed in paper.
Dr. Blum?
Well, actually, I was going to ask all three, but maybe Dorothea would be the best, because her presentation was the most maybe theoretical and methodological in nature. So my question to you is, how do you know anything? In other words, when you finally think you've discovered something, how do you know that?
I didn't want to talk about this aspect. Because most of my colleagues don't like to talk about the inside. I have had colleagues, very, very good scientists, who had seen the final result during meditation. I have seen, I know people that have spent many, many years on some problem and they're never sure in the result. So this is very individual. And how do you know? You have some, depending on the field in which you're working, you have, in some fields you have validation studies, sensitivity studies, where you can compare with observations. And you can have certain level, you can have a level of certainty. It's never 100%. Often after 10, 20 years, it's proven wrong. All parameterization that you have done have been really accepted very well, and then another one comes that is better. So how can I answer your question? I don't have a real answer.
Okay, well, it's not an easy question, so thank you.
Other questions for our speakers? Well, thank you so very much for, yes, Dr. Grout.
I want to make a comment. I've been here since 1984, and Sarah's been here that whole time. She's been the librarian that whole time. And Brad made a comment about how quick results were when he asked somebody on the staff to find some paper. That, I've done that many times over these 26 years. And one time I was on my way to lunch, I stopped and dropped off a reference, went to lunch, came back, and the printed article, paper, from some German scientific journal was in my tray outside my office an hour later. But and the staff here has turned over in those 26 years, but the one constant has been Sarah. She is amazing at the people she's hired and how much she gets out of them and how much she gets excellence out of them. I've been very impressed.
Goes to Leanne Harward. Sets the bar of excellence and meets it. So thank you very much for coming today. We appreciate it. And congratulations on all of your scholarship and your presentations and publications.
Thank you.
Thank you.